Hi there, my name's Andy Young and I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland, New Zealand, and welcome to my Andy Mechanic YouTube channel. Now, I've just finished on the previous video doing a full rebuild of the front brake master cylinder. We fitted new pistons, new seals, all that kind of stuff, did a thorough inspection, and I'm now on to the second part of overhauling the front brake system, and that's the front brake caliper. So, without further ado, I'm going to pull the caliper off, we're going to strip it down completely, inspect it of course, and provided that the casting and the pistons are up to, you know, serviceable condition, then I'll show you how to reinstall the new seals, rebuild the caliper, and refit it onto the bike again. I do already have quite a number of videos on this channel that cover a similar task, but I thought it'd be quite nice to do one that's specific to the infamous Yamaha TDR250. Here we go. Okay, well, removing the front caliper is dead easy on one of these bikes. All we need to do, first of all, is just undo this little clamp on the fork leg. And just while I'm doing that, there is another video of me reconditioning these front forks. If you ever need to do that on one of your bikes, they're pretty much a generic fork, so it covers cover heaps of different bikes out there. The basic principle of fitting new fork seals and how to strip the forks down and what to clean and all that kind of stuff. Pretty good. Okay, right, that's that bit out of the way. Now it's important that you undo that because it allows the brake pipe to hang away from the disc because it's going to dribble some brake fluid, and the last thing you want is brake fluid on your brake disc. That's very, very bad. Yeah, like you see, lots of brake fluid coming out. Find a rag. There we go, look, cool. Okay. Yeah, keep the brake fluid off your brake disc under all circumstances. There we go. Right, and don't lose the little washers, although you'll need to replace these copper washers when you come to reinstall the caliper. Right, two more bolts. Right. Thread lock, that's why it's tight. These bolts should always have thread lock. In fact, any bolt that relates to a brake component should really have thread lock on it. There we go, look, that's one. Two. Right, so we'll just tuck that out of the way. I'll stick it in there, look. That'll do. Then it'll go mental. Can't do that. No, I shouldn't do really. Sorry, Ben. Stick it over there. Dribble down that side. That'll work. Okay, right. One caliper. Okay, I'm going to need a big flat screwdriver. Nope, there goes all the brake fluid. Cool, let that dribble out for a second. Right, we'll spin that back round to the fork. And we can lever off there, can't we? There we go. Bit awkward with the camera anyway. Ta-da. Okay, so we've got the caliper off the bike now. All that's left to do is to strip the whole thing down. Now, you may also notice this caliper has got a number of bolts, and that's because this is what's called a fixed caliper. It doesn't float, doesn't have any sliders, it's a fixed caliper. And these are a lot more popular on performance cars and motorcycles. Now, in order to get the pistons out, what we need to do is split the entire caliper. We've got to undo all four of those bolts. And between these two halves of the casting, we're going to find a transfer port. We're going to find a little drilling that has an O-ring, and that O-ring must be replaced. You cannot reuse it, otherwise you risk getting a bit of a brake fluid leak. And again, if you get a brake fluid leak, it's going to get on your brake pads, it's going to contaminate those, it's going to get on your brake disc, and it's going to contaminate that too. So, really bad idea. Plus, looks like we've got a bit of cleaning up to do. Yeah, that could be Ben's job. Okay, so we'll get that pulled apart, we'll get the pads taken out, and we'll split the caliper, and then I'll show you how to get the pistons taken out. Here we go. Okay, well, I suppose the first job is to remove this little plastic cover here, look. Dead spider. Right. And now we've got these two little pins to remove so we can extract the brake pads. Now, they should have, one's missing by the looks of it, these little R-clips. So we've got an R-clip there, look. So we'll take that out. And there should be one on this one as well. Where are you? Oh, there he is. Perfect. Okay, so we'll have that one out as well. And if you have lost those, then a small split pin will do the trick. Now take note of which way up the spring goes. That's important too, otherwise you'll get pad chatter. Right, I'll show you what to do with those pins later on. Now, let's take the caliper out of the vise. Just to remove those. Yeah. Now, next job is to undo these four bolts. I'll just turn it around in the vise so you can see what's going on. Nice and tight. In fact, let's just put it like that, look. There you go. Cool. And that's a number 8. I think. Oh no, number 6. My fault. There we go. Okay, 1, 2, three, 4. Great job. Okay. Now, I'm not sure if these are all the same size, so we'll just keep them in order. Can find out. Yep, same size, don't need to keep them in order. Excellent. One less thing to get wrong. Now, oh, I've got two. So you can see here, look, we've got the two rubber O-rings. We've got two transfer ports, one here and one here. And you've got two of the pistons here, look, and there's two still left in there. So we'll just flick those rubbers out because we'll be replacing those. There we go, that's one. Now, I dare say this caliper has never been stripped. So, always a first time. Mind you, saying that, that rubber O-ring is definitely not the same as that one. So I lied to you. It looks like somebody else has already been in here and they've used what looks like a non-standard part. Now, when you're replacing these O-rings, it's really important that you use the proper parts because you need to use O-rings that don't get affected by brake fluid, obviously, because they're going to be running with brake fluid all the time. It looks like that one of them has swollen up. It's reacted to the brake fluid, so yeah, not good. Okay, so that's one half. And there's the other half, look. And again, we've got those two transfer ports just here, look. So the next job is to extract those pistons. Now I'm pretty sure Ben hasn't bought new pistons, so I'm hoping that they're going to clean up okay, but chances are they're going to be pretty rusty being 28 years old, but we'll soon find out. Here we go. Right, so I've got the one half of the caliper mounted in the vise. I'm just going to use a couple of G clamps just to limit the travel of those pistons. So I'm just going to stop basically one piston moving. A little bit of slack on there. Don't want to fire out on me because it's actually quite painful. And let's do the same with that. And we're going to work the pistons out very slowly. That should work for that one. Okay, and got the old trusty airline. And I've put a bit of rubber hose on the end, and that's going to help to make a seal against one of the transfer ports, which is that one there. Look, I'm just going to put my thumb over the transfer port that, because it's got two. It's not normal to have two, but it's got two, just to seal that, and then we can. There we go. That's one. Excellent. And that G clamp should limit the travel now. Cool. Okay, let's go back in a little bit with it. I don't want it to come all the way out because then we'll lose. There we go. That's all freed off now. Right, now for this one. So we can back that off a little bit. And we should be able to start getting the second one to move. Now there's lots of different ways and methods of getting pistons out of calipers. It's a bit harder when it's a split type like this, where it's a you know, a fixed caliper. Come on, other piston, you can do it. There we go. Excellent. Okay. And still got all my fingers. Fantastic. Right, so now you can remove the G clamps out of the way, and those pistons should just wiggle out, I reckon. And then I'll do exactly the same thing with the other half. At this point in time, they might be okay. That's one. Now, on this particular caliper, it looks like the pistons are all the same. Not entirely sure because I've not ordered new ones, so I can't tell by the part numbers. There we go. Great stuff. So it looks like we might be okay, but we won't know until we clean them up. Right. Second half. I don't need that anymore. Okay. Right. Now, on this one, we've got three holes. So I'm going to... I have a little adapter that I use that uses an old banjo bolt that connects into there. And I'm going to have to blank off both of the transfer ports. So I'll work something out for that, and then we'll get these two pistons taken out. Okay, so we've got two G clamps back in place on the two pistons, piece of steel plate with some bits of cardboard to act a bit like a gasket. Hopefully it's going to work, not too sure. And we've got the little, the old brake pipe banjo tool that I use to give an air supply in. Let's just see what happens. I'm not entirely sure this is going to work. I think we might get a leak down there, but who knows? It might work. We've got movement. Okay. A little leakage going on. Thing to bear in mind is we're only using about 90 psi of air pressure to remove pistons that are normally moved by about 1000 psi. Okay, let's give it another go. It's a bit Heath Robinson this, I'm not too happy with it, but it's sort of the problems that you get when you've got a fixed caliper. There we go. Okay, so that one's not far off now. Excellent. Right, just this last remaining piston to get out, which is that one down there. There we go. Bingo. Okay, well, so all the pistons stripped out, so we can give those a clean up and inspect those, and hopefully they'll be okay. Right. Pretty manky. Okay, well, first job with the pistons is just to clean off all the crap with a wire brush. And that'll give us a good idea of what sort of condition they're in before we clean them up. You know, final stages. Okay, well, we've got a bit of munching going on there, look. There's a mark there and one there. Somebody else has obviously already been in. And round there as well. This piston's knackered. Damn. That's really bad. And this was the one that was really hard to get out. Another mark there, look. You see, somebody's definitely been in with some mole grips and not used some rubber pipe on there. You can see that there on the camera or not, but there's heaps and heaps of score marks and delves and stuff, which Ben's not going to be very happy. Shit. Okay, well, here he comes. He's been in for lunch. Hey, Ben.
Mm-hmm.
You have a problem?
Yeah, really?
Not that one.
Ooh. It's not so good.
Somebody's been using mole grips to get them out. Because we've not stripped this one before, have we?
No.
You didn't get new pistons, did you?
Can't get them.
What do you mean you can't get them?
Well, yambits don't do.
Don't they?
Nope.
Shit. That's not good.
No. But that bit only goes into the seal when it's got new pads in it.
Yeah.
So they do stick out quite far as they were, those pads.
Yeah, well, that much. Certainly, at least onto the dust seal, because your main seal is a bit further back, look. So I might as well just wing it.
Yep, might have to just do for now. You only get some new pads, maybe new pistons in if I can get some.
See if you can source some, yeah.
Or do the old Blue Spot R1 caliper upgrade.
Do it fit those forks?
Yep, bolt straight on. Exactly.
Sounds a good idea. And are those still 4-pot or the 8-pot or what?
I think they're still 4-pot. But they have the back of the pistons there, those anodized blue.
Oh, much easier to get in and out then, isn't it?
Yeah.
Cool.
Poor TDR.
Yeah, so you want me to rebuild it with the new seals that you've already bought, but with these pistons?
Yeah.
For now. Okay.
Yeah, we don't really have another choice.
Not really, because you want to be riding it, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, and I dread to think how much new pistons would be. I'd rather put that money towards a Blue Spot caliper.
Yeah, well, if you can't get parts for these calipers anymore, it's pointless, isn't it?
Mm.
Okay, it's not looking good, actually. I mean, you can see this on the camera or not, but there's... In fact, I'll do a close-up for you, but you can see there, look, there's some damage where somebody's stripped these calipers down in the past. And they've marked the pistons, and those marks are too far in, and they're actually going to run against the main seal, which is a huge problem. And this is the problem that was really hard to get out. So you can see those marks there, look really clearly now. Really weird imprint, but if you follow it all the way around, there's so many. It's just way beyond reuse, really. Even around there, look. Buggered. Okay, but we have a plan. Okay, so even though this is the only one, the other three are fine. Well, not fine, but they'll do. These pistons, even through yambits, are no longer available, unfortunately, which means that we're going to have to put the caliper back together with these pistons in short term. Now, it wasn't leaking in the past, and if I flat off all those damaged bits, then hey, we might be okay for a short time. And I mean, the pads are already half worn, which means that at the moment that damage isn't going to run against the main seal, so we shouldn't have any fluid leaks, which is important. You know, we're going to be, the seal's going to be running on the still good rear part of the piston. And I'm told by Ben, through his research, that one of the older current, well, what about 2004, 2005 R1s, the front caliper, the right-hand front caliper off an R1 will fit the same mounting points as on the TDR fork. And it's been done before, so I think, and you can get parts for those as well, so that's definitely going to be the way forward, I think. So we'll put this caliper back together with the new seals that Ben's already purchased, knowing that in the future, at some point, when these pads get low, we're going to have to replace the whole caliper. Okay, here we go. Okay, so before we clean the rest of these caliper bodies up, seem to flick out the old seals. So that's the main seal coming out there, look. I'm not too concerned about damaging it because it's going to go in the bin anyway. That's one. And now the dust seal. These tend to be pretty corroded behind these. So just to get easy, there we go, look. And all that corrosion you can see on the outside of the seal. That one's not too bad. A bit around there, look. That corrosion there, that buildup of oxidization, tends to push the seals harder against the piston, and it affects piston retraction. So you've got to make sure that these are fully cleaned out. I'll do all that a bit later on. Okay. Next seal. There we go. And the dust seal. Cool. Right, Ben. You can clean that one up. And same again. Wow. They're really stuck in, aren't they? Cool. Good stuff. Right, cleaning time. Right, in an attempt to try and keep these pistons working for a little bit longer. Jeez, look at all that. Bad, isn't it? Let's see what we can come up with. So I've just got a bit of P800 wet and dry here. Just using it dry at the moment. Just really want to get rid of the sharp edges so it doesn't damage the new seals. There's no way I'm going to get these grooves completely eliminated because they're way too deep, but a little bit of prep work would be good. Jeez. God, I hate to see that. Should go in the bin. Should be going in the bin, Benjamin Young. Thank you. Okay. That's just going to have to do for that one, I think. Okay. Last one. So we've got one good one out of all of them. Well, that's the best, but it's still being munched, look. Bad, bad mechanic. Jeez. Right, I'll just do one to camera, but you need to make sure that all this crap from these grooves where the seals sit, and this is the dust seal groove here, is completely clear. Otherwise, it basically pushes the seal against the piston and affects... There's too much resistance and it affects piston retraction and that kind of stuff, so it's a real problem and it needs to be done. And yes, it takes ages. There's no shortcuts. Just do it. Have a beer. The same goes for the main seal groove as well, you know. It's imperative that all that crap's dug out. Go away, fly. Nobody wants you. Take your family away. Right, so I'm going to continue cleaning all these up, and once all the grooves are clean, I'll show you how to reassemble the caliper. Cool.
Right, I'm back. It's now Sunday, 2 days after I started doing this video. But I was busy doing warrants all day yesterday. So Ben's now cleaned off the inside of these caliper bodies, both the dust seal groove and the main seal, the square section main seal groove, on all four, nice and clean, all the residue, all the corrosion taken out. Now I was reading through the official Yamaha TDR 250 workshop manual this morning, and it says, during the disassembly, under no circumstances should you be undoing these four bolts. These are the four bolts that hold the two halves of the casting together. But it says not to do that to remove the pistons. Now, okay, some of these calipers, you can get the pistons out, although it's very difficult with the caliper body still bolted together. But cleaning it up, getting in there with your little screwdriver or your little pick, getting all the corrosion out, yeah, that's not going to happen. So realistically, you're going to have to pull them apart. Otherwise, it's going to be extremely difficult, hard to see what you're doing, and difficult for access. Okay, well, we've got the new parts for the seals, and there we go, look, put one there. And you're going to need four of these kits, okay, in order to do this job. Now, obviously, you can get them from Yamaha, or you can get them from Yambits, or basically anywhere else that you choose. Okay, I'll chuck a couple of seals in. I won't do all four to camera, all eight, actually, to camera. I'll just do, you know, one side, and then you get the idea. And then we can get the caliper put back together and put back on the bike. Here we go. Okay. Right, try and get these nice and clean. One main seal, one dust seal. Now, we're going to need some brake fluid. It's important that you use brake fluid as your assembly sort of lubricant. You mustn't use grease or WD-40 or anything like that, because all that kind of stuff, even rubber grease, it changes the coefficient of friction between the seal itself and the surface of the piston, which affects piston retraction. Whereas brake fluid, that's what it's going to be running in anyway. So the whole thing's designed to work with that. So Let's do the main seal first, because that's the one that's further back. And we're just going to pop that in there like that. It's a bit fiddly, and you might want to use your old blunt screwdriver to help you, just to poke it into place. Okay, you can see there, look, got an abundance of seal. I'm just going to make sure that it's in all the way around. Super careful not to damage it. Tell you what, let's just make sure we've got the right seal. Ah, okay.
Damn. It looks like Yambits have either had the wrong parts listed on their website, or they've just sent us the wrong ones, because that is the original main seal out of one of the pistons, and this one is what they've sent us. And unfortunately, the diameter is significantly different. You can see that a lot on there. There you go, look. So it is quite a lot different, and obviously it's not going to work. So maybe they're the rear ones, I don't know. But the bottom line is, we don't have any new seals now for this caliper, and I don't want it lying around in the workshop in bits after I've cleaned it all up. So it's going to go back together. I've cleaned off all the original seals, have given them a good inspection, and actually they don't look too bad. And remember, there were no problems of leakage with this caliper. Essentially, it just wasn't providing much braking performance. Now, that could have been contributed to the, you know, leak by in the master cylinder, or it could have been down to sort of some binding pistons in the caliper itself, or just contaminated brake pads, we don't know. So we'll do the best we can, and I think realistically Ben's just going to have to source one of those R1 calipers, what they call the blue pot calipers, and then that way we can recondition one of those, and it'll have super powerful brakes, because they are very, very good. I think the piston diameters must be slightly larger. Okay, so we've got the main seals, we've got the dust seals, and I'll show you how to install them. Here we go. Right, we will try again. Okay, so I've got one of the main seals. This is the original main seals now. Going back in. Make sure you lube it up properly. Plenty of brake fluid, and only use brake fluid. I keep stressing that. But you've got plenty of it, so that's easy. And we'll just see if we can get that started off. It's not the easiest thing to do. Some just drop straight in. Some are a real pain. Okay, we're getting there. Don't like using screwdrivers. There we go. Okay, now, as you can see here, look, it's not quite sat properly. So we're just going to give that a little tweak. There we go. So make sure that the square section seal is actually sat all the way in the groove. It's pretty much flush. There we go. Okay, so that's the main seal, the square section main seal. And it's that one there that's responsible for piston retraction. Now, I did do a video a while ago explaining what piston retraction is. And it's extremely important. If you don't have any, your brakes are going to bind on. And if you have too much, you're going to have a low pedal or a lever that comes a lot closer to the handlebars. In this case, it would be a motorcycle that it should do. And, you know, if you're interested to see what that's all about and some more detail on that, then watch that video. Okay, right. Dust seal. Now, with the dust seals, these have got a little, like a double lip on the inner. That's what runs against the piston. And then it's the smooth side that runs in the groove. Okay, same again. Fiddly as always. There we go. Almost. Now, if you're going to be using a scribe or anything like that, make sure it's not too sharp. You don't want to be damaging the seal.
There we go. Cool. Right. So that one is in. So we can pop the piston in as well if you like. So we'll grab one of our pistons. Again, I'll only use brake fluid as a lubricant. And the piston should just push in. You shouldn't need to use any kind of help, any kind of force. Where did that come from? It should just slide in quite happily. And obviously, it's this side to the outside. I've seen students put these in the wrong way around before, which is a real pain. Okay, there we go. And, oh, that's the dodgy one, look. Okay. Perfect. Okay, well, that's one done. I'll crack on and get the rest of these finished. And then we can get the caliper bolted back together. Well, that was nice and easy. See, that just shows this one was a bit harder to get in with that with the damage. This one flowed a lot easier. I'm hoping that's not going to cause a problem later on. Right, that's one half done. Now for some more fun. Very, very disappointed we haven't got the new seals. That's what I've been waiting for ages. But, as it turns out, these ones aren't too bad, so I suppose now that Ben's decided to buy a new DR1 caliper, do the conversion, then any money he can save, you know, is always good, because he spends a fortune on these bikes. It's not cheap. He has too many bikes. Actually, he doesn't. Too many bikes for me to fix. That's probably a better definition, isn't it? Oh, cool kicker on the roof. Right. Let's get past that main seal. There we go. Excellent. There we are. Right. Done. Brilliant. Now, as regards the transfer port seals, I have got a pair. They didn't come with a part number though, unfortunately, so what we're going to need to do is just drop those. One side's got the grooves, so you just drop them into the grooves like that. Make sure they're nice and clean. There we go. And now, we can just drop that over the top. Get a couple of bolts put in. Right, two more bolts. So yeah, imagine trying to do that with the without splitting the two casings. Trying to get in there, clean everything out and see what's going on and fitting the seals. No thanks, Yamaha. I think they just get scared with technicians doing stuff. Getting too involved with disassembly and things. Right, so we'll give these a tweak. Now these were M8 bolts, so I would say about 20 newton meters should be enough. Maybe 25, but I wouldn't go any more than that. But Yamaha don't give us a spec because we're not supposed to take it apart. Should work. Okay, 25 newton meters. We'll just do them all evenly, I think. I suppose we'll put the pads in now, that'll work, then they're all done. Cool, let's do that. Okay, well they look pretty good, not going to bother cleaning those up. Look fine. However, we'll just clean the ends up, I think. Because these pads, they run along the ends of the caliper here. This should be nice and clean with a bit of copper paste on there, otherwise it's going to cause the pads to stick. You can see some rust that's built up, and there should be copper paste on the back here where they make contact with the pistons as well. So I'll do all that and then we'll install the pads. There we go, just getting rid of the rough. When these pads are stamped out, the backing plates are stamped out, they get they're quite rough along there, and that can impede the flow of the pad, or the movement of the pad in the caliper. You can see there, look, it's different heights. There we go. That's one. And it's important that you don't contaminate the pads, and make sure you've got clean gloves. I do this to even brand new pads, even when I'm fitting them. Just chuck them in the vise, give them a quick check that they're nice and smooth on the contact points. See there, look, the difference. Cool. Okay, now then, what about the pins? How bad are these? When these pins come new, they're sort of zinc coated, they've got like a coating on them to stop them corroding, but over time they tend to rust. And they also wear too. This one's pretty good, so I'll leave that as it is, just a bit of copper paste on there. If they're rusty, and they get that a lot on the quad bikes, then you've got to give them a clean up with every cloth to get rid of the corrosion. Again, it can cause the pads to not to move freely when the brakes are applied and then, you know, disengaged. Cool. Right, so let's put a little tiny bit of copper paste. On there, down the side. We don't want to risk getting any on the brake pad at all. Because that's not going to be very good, is it? And of course, on the back where the pistons make contact. This is very much like a car kind of thing, culture really doing this. Didn't used to do it in England, but yeah, I found it helps. There we go. It's so important you don't contaminate the pads at this point as well, because copper paste is not good on your brake pads, on the material. Obviously all brake pads are different, so you've got to just look to see where the contact points are, where the pad rubs on the pad carrier, and that's basically where you need to put the copper paste. Okay, that's those two done. And now just the sliders, the actual pins. Again, those pads have got to slide on those freely. And just a little tiny thin layer. Now don't go putting too much on there.
Perfect. Right. Get these popped back in. We'll just do one at a time. Now we've got that spring to fit as well, haven't we? So how the hell did that go on? Maybe I should watch my own video. That basically sits underneath those pins, so we'll have to just like that, look. So we'll just pull that pin out and slide it under. There we go. And that just stops the pads from rattling around. Doesn't help when you don't 2 days have gone since you pulled something apart. Now lastly is the little R clips. And you see just there, look, I'll turn that one around a bit. There's a hole in the retaining pins. And they just pop into there like that. It's pretty good that we still have the original R clips. Because they often get lost. People use, you know, split pins and stuff, nails, whatever they can find kicking around to do the same job. Okay, and finally, get rid of the spider. That goes on there, like that. Right, that's ready to go back on the bike. I can bleed up the brakes. Super job. Right, I'm just putting some thread lock onto the bolts. Ben's stolen my other thread lock, so this is out of one of those sort of tubes. It's a lot thicker, it's not liquid, and the tube is almost run out, so just transferring a bit using a little screwdriver. Okay, it is important that you use thread lock on these caliper retaining bolts. You don't want them coming undone. Okay, a bit awkward with the camera in the way. I think. There we go. 12. Now there will be a torque setting for these, and I'll put it on the screen for you about now. There we go. Okay, next job is that brake pipe. Now remember to use new copper washers on your banjo bolt, that's very important. Prevent any kind of leaks, you shouldn't reuse them. There we go. Great stuff. And finally, just that little metal plate
8. Done. So there you go. That's the front caliper on the Yamaha TDR, sorry, infamous Yamaha TDR250. Removed, stripped down, inspected, not new seals fitted, pistons cleaned up, reassembled, and put back on the bike. Now, obviously, all that's left to do now is to bleed up the brakes. Now, I've got plenty of videos out there showing you how to bleed up brake systems. I'm not going to include it in this video. If you don't know how to bleed the brakes, then hey, watch one of those videos. And don't forget also that video that covers piston retraction. It's a really short video. It's really good. There's some really good close-up shots to explain to you exactly what piston retraction is, how you test for it, and why it's so important. Okay, well, my name is Andy Young. I'm one of the automotive lecturers down at Unitech in Auckland, New Zealand. And you've been watching my Andy Mechanic YouTube channel. Now, if you'd love to subscribe, then click on the subscribe button. I think it's this side. I don't know. One side. Both sides. Who knows? Click on the subscribe button and you'll see a little gear icon. If you click on the gear icon, then of course you can turn on notifications and you'll get an email sent through to you as and when I upload any new videos. And there's usually 3 or 4 a week at the moment. Pretty busy. You'll also find me on Facebook, Instagram, Google Plus, and Twitter, and feel free to communicate through any of those portals. However, I would prefer for you to use YouTube as your first choice, because one of the questions that you ask, or the question that you ask, and I answer it, may also be the same question that somebody else asks, and they can just read the answer, and they get an immediate, response, basically, to their question, rather than having to wait for me to get back to them. And I do try to get back as soon as possible, but I'm a busy chap, got lots to do. Okay, well, thanks a lot for watching. Hope you found it helpful. Take care. Cheers. Over and out.